Hi guys, welcome to Applebee Academy's live session. I know you're preparing for your Indian NET exam which is scheduled on May. And in today's live session, we are going to have a detailed discussion on one of the most important topic that you never want to miss if you're preparing for NTA NET exam. And we are going to have a look on the most important writer, that is Samuel Taylor Coleridge. In the previous live session, we already discussed about William Wordsworth, and I had already told you that William Wordsworth, he was an important figure both in the field of literature and also in the field of literary criticism. Similarly, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, he's also a very important figure if you're preparing for NTA NET exam, because you can expect at least one question from Coleridge for every exams. And there are only one or two exams in which you couldn't find a question about Coleridge. Even in that exam, you would find an option about Coleridge. So Coleridge is a very important topic that you have to look if you're going to have a look on NTA NET exam. So about Samuel Taylor Coleridge, in this live session, we will be discussing about the important poems and important collections written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. At the same time, in our second section, we will also be looking at Samuel Taylor Coleridge as a literary critic. So you might be familiar with Samuel Taylor Coleridge. And Coleridge, as we all know, he was an English poet, a literary critic, a philosopher, and a theologian. And as we all know, along with his friend William Wordsworth, he was a founder of this romantic movement. And therefore, as I said earlier, Samuel Taylor Coleridge and William Wordsworth, both of them are very important from literary point of view. And he was also a member of the Lake Poets, and he shared his collections and his writings with the writers like William Wordsworth, Charles Lamb, Robert Saday, etc. And even his criticism on William Shakespeare was also highly influential. And about Coleridge, discussing about the biographical details of Samuel Taylor Coleridge, he read the Bible and Arabian Nights from a young age, and even in the works of Hazlitt, in which he explained about his acquaintance with Coleridge, you can find that Coleridge is often explained, or Coleridge is often described by his contemporaries as a genius. As we know, he read the Bible and the Arabian Nights from a young age, and this might be one important thing that actually altered, or that actually gave more importance for his imagination. He joined the British Army under the name Silas Tomkin Cumberbatch, and he met Charles Lamb and Leigh Hunt at Christ Hospital School. So about Charles Lamb, as I said earlier, he published collections along with William Wordsworth. We know about the lyrical ballads we discussed in the previous live session. And Charles Lamb, he also shared a great bond with Charles Lamb, William Hazlitt, Robert Saday, etc. So he was basically a very respectable poet of that time. And Charles Lamb, he later recorded the school life in the essay Christ Hospital 5 and 30 years ago. So in the essay Christ Hospital 5 and 30 years ago, you could find the relationship between Charles Lamb and Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Moving on, and in the school, he fell in love with Mary Evans, and he was a founder of the Romantic movement in England and a member of the Lake Poets. And after his school days, he moved to this university and he met Robert Saday, and they made a plan on the basis of Plato's Republic to found a utopian society called Pandisocracy. So you can find that Coleridge and Saday, both of them, they decided to create a place called Pandisocracy, which is based on Thomas More's utopia. So he wanted to create this utopian society in Britain, and this was their attempt to do it. And he went to Germany and Rome later, and he started a paper called The Friend. So remember, The Friend is a paper started by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. After his return from Germany, he befriended William Wordsworth. And as we all know, this befriending, or this friendship, created the manifesto of romantic movement, that is the lyrical ballads. So their friendship is very important in British literature. And they together published lyrical ballads in 1798. Then you could find that he suffered from many diseases, and consequently, in order to get a relief from the pain that was caused because of these diseases, he took opium, and later he became an opium addict. So many of his writings, like Cristobal, Xanadu, you can find that these writings he had written under opium influence. And he was also known as the Sage of Highgate. He was also known as the Sage of Highgate. He was a theologian. He was a priest. And Coleridge was developing a new informal mode of poetry in which he could use a conversational tone and rhythm to give unity to a poem. So we know, we have already discussed about the approach of William Wordsworth towards poems and towards literature. So in this session, we will be discussing about the approach of Samuel Taylor Coleridge. And later, though their friendship was a great mark, or being the founding of the or began the romantic movement in England, later he got dissatisfied with the ideas and ideologies followed by William Wordsworth, and they took a break, and that started the darkest phase of the life of Coleridge. And then his marriage to Sarah Fricker, it also turned to be an unhappy one. And so the years after the publication of Lyrical Ballads, or after being split away from William Wordsworth, were not good years for him. And that is another reason for his depression. In September 2020, there was a question from Coleridge. So remember, we are discussing this question because these are the areas that you have to look while you are preparing for NTA exam and from Coleridge. So you have to look at what the other authors had said about Coleridge, the remarks of other writers on Coleridge, then the important poems and collections, and also the criticisms of Coleridge. As mentioned in my first acquaintance with poets, which poet does William Hazlitt describe as the only person who answered the idea of a man of genius? So William Hazlitt, in his work, My First Acquaintance with Poets, in which he describes his acquaintance with poets like Coleridge and William Wordsworth. So the question is, who does Hazlitt feel like the only person who answered the idea of a man of genius? As I said earlier, Coleridge was honored. He was admired by many of his contemporaries for being a man of genius. And therefore, the answer is Samuel Taylor Coleridge. That is option one. Now moving to our second section, that is, in this session, we are going to have a look on the notable works written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. In the first session, we discussed about the biographical details regarding Coleridge and what other critics had to say of Coleridge. And in this session, we are going to have a look on the notable works written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. So these are the eight conversation poems. As I said earlier, he was a man of experiments. He wanted to bring an informal mode to poetry. And Coleridge, he was an influential figure for the figures like Emerson, and also for American movement called Transcendentalism. And these are the eight conversation poems that he wrote during his lifetime. That is Dejection and Ode, The Aeolian Harp, Fears in Solitude, Frost at Midnight, The Nightingale, a conversation poem, Reflections on Having Left a Place of Retirement, This Lime Tree Bore My Prison, to William Wordsworth. So these are the eight conversation poems written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. So questions can be asked like, which among the following is not a poem written by Coleridge, or which among the following is not a conversation poem. So try to remember the names of these poems. These are the eight conversation poems written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. And moving in precise with some of the important poems, the first one is The Aeolian Harp. The Aeolian Harp, it discusses Coleridge's anticipation of a marriage with Sarah Fricker, along with the pleasure of the conjugal love. It focuses on man's relationship with nature, and the central image of the poem is an Aeolian harp. So you have to remember one important thing. Samuel Taylor Coleridge, he was a romantic. He's a romantic poet, and therefore his reverence, his admiration towards the nature is very much evident in his work. And this particular poem, the Aeolian Harp, is written on the basis of his relationship with his wife Sarah, or his going to be wife Sarah Fricker. And it also speaks about a man's relationship with nature. And you can find that the Aeolian harp, it represents order and also wildness in nature. And this poem, it contains a discussion on one life. And one life is a Coleridge idea that humanity and nature are united, along with his desire to try to find the divine within nature. So he brings an important discussion about this important topic, that is one life. So remember, Aeolian harp, it opens a discussion on the topic called one life. And the poem begins with "My pansy Zara." Okay, as I said earlier, this is written on his anticipation with his anticipation of his marriage with Sarah Fricker, and therefore the poem opens with the line "My pensive Sarah." Moving to the next poem, that is "Frost at Midnight." Frost at Midnight. This poem, it basically discusses about the childhood of Coleridge, and that too in a negative manner. So he never had a positive childhood, and he discusses about his childhood in a negative manner. And since he couldn't be raised in a countryside, he wants his children to be raised in the countryside, to be more close with nature, so that they would have a very peaceful and a very harmonious life. It expresses the hope that Coleridge's son Hartley would be able to experience a childhood that his father could not, and become a true child of nature. So Coleridge always laments for the fact that he couldn't be close with the nature during his childhood days, and he wanted his son Hartley to be raised in a countryside so that he can be very close with nature, he can be a child of nature. Moving to the next poem, that is This Lime Tree Bore My Prison. The poem discusses a time in which Coleridge was forced to stay beneath a lime tree while his friends were able to enjoy the countryside. So this is another poem where he starts in a very negative manner, because he had to stay under a lime tree throughout a night, all through the night, while his friends were able to enjoy the countryside. And here he was able to connect to the nature just like how his friends could connect to the nature, or how his friends celebrated with nature. And these are some other poetry collections of Coleridge. Poems on various subjects and The Watchman. The Watchman was published in the year 1796, and it covers almost 10 issues, and about the contemporary problems and politics, so about the liberal political periodical, and it was printed every 8 days. So The Watchman, so remember The Watchman, it was published in the year 1796, and there were 10 issues of this work. So they collected 10 issues, and in order to avoid the tax that had to pay for a weekly journal, they published it after every 8 days. Okay, so if you are publishing it for every 7 days, then you have to pay the tax for the weekly journals. So they started to publish it after every 8 days. Now coming to another famous poem written by Coleridge, that is Kubla Khan, A Vision in a Dream. Kubla Khan, A Vision in a Dream. The poem was composed one night after he experienced an opium-influenced dream. So as I said earlier, he suffered from many diseases, and in order to relieve from the pain, he started taking opium, and later he became an opium addict. And on one such night, while he took opium, he had this dream. And this is considered to be the most beautiful poem of Coleridge, which is left unfinished. Okay, so that is one negative side of Kubla Khan, that this Kubla Khan was left unfinished. And he basically dreams about this place because he read about this palace in a book, and that might be one reason for his dream. And anyhow, this describes Xanadu, the summer palace of the Mongol ruler and the emperor of China, Kublai Khan. So upon waking, he set about writing. So he had this dream, and after waking, he was all set to write a poetry about, or write a poem about what he dreamt. And he started writing this poem until he was interrupted. Okay, he was interrupted by a person from Pollock. So remember, a person from Pollock is right now used as a metaphor or used as an expression to represent or to symbolize a man who hinders an artistic expression or an artistic creation. So when this man from Pollock came to visit Coleridge, he had to stop writing this poem, and the flow, he never got it back. So the book Coleridge was reading before he fell asleep was Purchas's Pilgrims by the English clergyman and geographer Samuel Purchas, and this might be one reason that induced his dreams. And he was forced by Lord Byron to publish. Since it was left unfinished, he never wanted to publish it. But Lord Byron considered it to be a most beautiful poem, even though it was left unfinished. And that's how Coleridge published this particular Kubla Khan. And then we have the Rime of Ancient Mariner. I'm so sure that most of you might be familiar with this particular poem, the Rime of Ancient Mariner, because you might have learned it either in your school or in any of your college days, either in your PG or your UG, because Rime of Ancient Mariner, it is a very beautiful and a very strong poem written by Coleridge, which speaks about the power of narration. Okay, so this is such a very wonderful work. And it was first published in Lyrical Ballads. So this is the first poem of the Lyrical Ballads when it was published in 1798. And later he revised it and was published in Zibeline Leaves. It relates the experiences of a sailor who has returned from a long sea voyage. So I hope you know about the story of, or the plot line of Ancient Mariner. So it discusses about, or it tells the, it relates the experiences of a sailor who is back from a long sea voyage. And this long sea voyage was nothing peaceful. And he wanted to tell the story of this voyage to three people, and that is how he stops a wedding guest from entering the wedding. So he stops his wedding guest and he starts to tell the story. So if you have ever read this poem, you know that it beautifully describes about the power of narration, how this man, how this captain, how this sailor stops this guest from entering, and how his glittering eyes could stop that man from moving. So the mariner, he stops a man who is on his way to a wedding ceremony and begins to narrate a story. He uses narrative techniques such as personification and repetition to create a sense of danger and supernatural. So this was one important reason, or this is two extreme areas in which Wordsworth and Coleridge. So Wordsworth, he wanted the poet to be like a man who speaks to men, while Coleridge, he wants his language to be a little pretentious with fantasy, with some superstitious element in order to bring this willing suspension of disbelief. So in Jan 2017, there was this question from the Ancient Mariner: which statement best expresses the theme of Coleridge, the Rime of Ancient Mariner? Which statement best expresses the theme of Coleridge, the Rime of Ancient Mariner? So you have to identify the theme of this poem, the Rime of Ancient Mariner. To kill a living creature is immoral. People should honor and respect all living things. Prayer can accomplish miracles. True harmony is achieved only through a cooperative effort. So the answer is option number two. That is, people should honor and respect all living things. Because you know that what happens to this sailor? Once an albatross, a big bird, it comes to this ship. And this sailor, being pride of what he is, he kills this albatross. And after that, they were facing all the extremities of the sea. So this ship, it became like a painted ship upon the painted ocean. So it became frozen. This says, I hope you remember the words, water, water, everywhere, not a drop to drink. So at first they couldn't find a land to sail. Then they became frozen in sea. So the other soldiers, they believe that it is a curse of the albatross who was killed just because the sailor wanted to have a fun. And they took this albatross and put it as a token of regret on the neck of this sailor. So the moral or the major theme that Coleridge describes here is that people should honor and respect all living things. In November 2017, there was another question from Ancient Mariner. So before, while you are preparing for your NET exam, remember Samuel Taylor Coleridge, Ancient Mariner, Christabel. These are some of the important points that you should never miss. Which novel by Joseph Conrad presents a young captain who, like Coleridge, Ancient Mariner, is haunted by the vision of a ship drifting in calm and swinging in light airs, with all the crew dying slowly about her decks, and who feels the sickness of my soul, the weight of my sins, my sense of unworthiness. So the sailor, while he was seeing all his fellow sailors, they are dying out of hunger, they are dying out of water, and now you could find that he is basically haunted by that factor. So the question is, which novel of Joseph Conrad does the protagonist have these characteristics of the sailor of the Ancient Mariner? So these are the options: Under Western Eyes, The Shadow Line, Victory, and The Rescue. The answer is option 2, that is The Shadow Line. Then we have another incomplete poem written by Coleridge, that is Christabel. It was published in 1816 and it is written in 2 parts. It is an incomplete Gothic ballad. And the story is about the Christabel, the titular character Christabel. This is basically about the encounter of Christabel with a stranger called Geraldine, who claims to have been abducted from her home by a band of rubmen. So Christabel, the titular character, she meets this girl called Geraldine in the forest, and Geraldine claims that she was abducted from her home by a band of young men. And Christabel, of course, being a very kind and generous woman, decides to get Geraldine into her care. But Geraldine later turns to be a witch. The poem remains unfinished, and Christabel was an influence on Edgar Allan Poe, particularly his poem The Sleeper. Okay, so remember, Christabel influenced Edgar Allan Poe's poem The Sleeper. And not just Edgar Allan Poe, but another novel, that is Carmilla, which was written by Joseph Sheridan, is a homage or adaptation of Christabel, and it is written in Christabel meter. So the poem, remember, it was written in Christabel meter. In November 2017, there was this question: which character created by Coleridge makes the following account of a harrowing experience? So you have to identify the character created by Coleridge that shares this experience. Five warriors seized me yestermorn, me, even me, a maid forlorn. They chalked my cries with force and fright, and tied me on a palfrey white. So the option, so the answer is option 1, that is Geraldine. So this is how Geraldine tells this story to Christabel. Okay, so I forgot to add the options. But remember, Geraldine is the character who claims that she was abducted by a band of rough men, 5 men, from while she was at home. And that is how Christabel gets her into her home. So moving to the next poem, that is Dejection and Ode. When he wrote this poem, Coleridge was addicted to opium. So this is another poem that he written being that he had written after being an opium addict. And this is also a time in which he was suffering from a little depression, because his he had got this disease, he had got this pain, he became an opium addict. At the same time, his marriage was facing a failure. So and again, he had fallen in love with Sarah Hutchinson. So everything was complicated for Coleridge at this time. And you can find that this Dejection and Ode is a poem which he dedicated, or which he had written to Sarah Hutchinson, his newfound love. And though this poem was written to her, this is actually a reply to William Wordsworth's poem, that is Resolution and Independence. So remember that. Dejection and Ode, written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge, is a response to William Wordsworth. Resolution and Independence. And you can find that Wordsworth is introduced into the poem as a counter to Coleridge, because Wordsworth is able to turn such a mood into a benefit and is able to be comforted. So here you can find that Coleridge is basically envious of Wordsworth in this particular poem, because he feels that Wordsworth, for him, everything is stable, the mood is perfect, but for Coleridge, he has no one to get, no one to comfort him. In December 2018, there was another question, and this is another important fact that you have to remember regarding the Coleridge poem, Dejection and Odd. That is, Dejection and Odd opens with an epigraph, which is a reference to So the answer is Ballad of Sir Patrick Spence. So moving to the next work, next poem written by Coleridge, that is to Wordsworth. So it is a response to poet William Wordsworth's The Prelude, called here That Prophetic Lay. So again, remember, to Wordsworth, written by Coleridge. To Wordsworth is a poem written by Coleridge as a response to William Wordsworth, another poem, that is The Prelude. In the previous live session, we discussed about Prelude, which he had written as a prelude to The Recluse, and which is considered to be the autobiographical philosophical poem written by William Wordsworth. So this is actually a response to that particular poem. And in this poem, you can find that Coleridge, he was basically praising William Wordsworth for understanding both the external and the human nature. So though they were sharing a little rough bond, the thing was that Coleridge basically admires Wordsworth for understanding the external and human nature, but at the same time, he also emphasizes Wordsworth's poetic achievement and downplaying Coleridge on. So this is actually the time in which Coleridge was more happy with the success of William Wordsworth rather than the success of his own. The next we have The Fall of Robespierre, which he had written in collaboration with Robert Surrey. So at the beginning of this session, I have already mentioned that he had written many poems in collaboration with his contemporary writers, including Charles Lamb, Robert Surrey. And this is the poem that he had written in collaboration with Robert Surrey. And this basically was about the downfall of Maximilian Robespierre, who was portrayed as a tyrant, but Sade's contribution praised him as a destroyer of despotism. So you can find that he was one time being considered as a tyrant by Coleridge, but in the same poem, Sade explains him as a destroyer of despotism. Then we have a tragedy written by Coleridge in blank verse, that is Osorio. And Osorio, as I said earlier, Coleridge, he has an affinity with this so-called gothic element, supernatural and fantasy. So here you can find that this play is notable for its gothic elements. Like, you can find everything related to supernatural, just like how we read the Dracula. There is a castle, there is a dungeon, there is a cave, and there are supernatural elements. So remember, the tragedy written in blank verse by Samuel Taylor Coleridge, that is Osorio. And that's all the important works written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. And now we are going to have a look on Coleridge as a literary critic. So Coleridge is one fine example of a romantic critic and a contemporary of William Wordsworth. So we know that William Wordsworth and Samuel Taylor Coleridge, both of them togetherly co-published this lyrical ballad. But later, William Wordsworth, he made all the clarifications in the preface to Lyrical Ballads, which is published in 1800. While you can see that Coleridge used Biographia Literaria in order to show his way of criticism or his way of how a poet should be. So let me share the screen. Okay, so Biographia Literaria. First thing that you have to remember here are the differences of voices or differences of opinions that Wordsworth and Coleridge had. So for Wordsworth, subject matter should be rustic. So for Wordsworth, it should be like a common man speaking to another common man, and therefore it should be in a common language, and the subject should be close to nature. The subject should be something that is rustic. While for Coleridge, as we have seen in Christabel or Osorio or the Ancient Mariner, he preferred more fantasy. So while Wordsworth said that his subject matter should be rustic, in Biographia Literaria, Coleridge makes clear that his characters, that means Wordsworth's characters, are not rural or they are not local. They are highly philosophical characters. So basically he says that without the knowledge of, or without being conscious of what his characters are, his characters shares the philosophical admirations or philosophical greatness of Wordsworth himself. So that's the first area in which Coleridge opposes the writings of William Wordsworth. Then about how Wordsworth believes that best part of languages comes from the interaction with nature. But Coleridge, he dismisses the idea because he believes that it comes from noble thoughts and ideas. It is not just how I am having a conversation with nature, but it comes from noble thoughts and ideas. So that is how best part of a language comes. Best poem uses the language of men. Best poems uses the language of men. But he says that it is impossible to use the language of man because every man has this so-called parole system in which the language of every man is unique. Okay, and therefore it is not easy to achieve this man's language. And also this language, according to Coleridge, it changes with class and status, and therefore it is very difficult to write according to a man's language. And Wordsworth said language of prose and poem is same. But Coleridge says no, there is supposed to be a difference between the language of poem and language of prose, especially with word order. So these are the differences that Wordsworth shared with Coleridge, or these are the areas that Coleridge criticizes William Wordsworth. And the next important concept that he discusses in his Biographia Literaria, that too in chapter 13, is a distinction between two types of imagination, primary imagination and secondary imagination. So as we all know, Coleridge, just like Wordsworth, is a romantic poet who believes in imagination and emotions, feelings and recreation. So here you can find that he makes a clear-cut division between the primary and secondary imagination. According to him, primary imagination is the reception of the finite mind of the eternal art of creation in the infinite. At the same time, secondary imagination, it is an active agent that dissolves, diffuses, dissipates in order to recreate. I will make it more clear. I will share this slide. So remember, imagination can be divided into two: primary imagination and secondary imagination. Primary imagination, that is creative, It is original, and this is something that is used unconsciously. For example, we all have this talent of primary imagination. When we hear a song, or when we hear our favorite song, we used to be creative. We put ourselves into that characters. We create a context, and we all have this primary imagination. And because human individual or a human mind has the power to produce images, and that is how this imagination works. And we have every human mind have this power to create an order. So that these are the functions that a primary imagination does. But secondary imagination is something that has to do with literariness. Secondary imagination is a poetic faculty. It is a poetic faculty which not only gives shape and order to a given world, but builds new worlds. So primary imagination, it shapes, it's like a bricolayer. So it shapes what you have in your mind or what you have in your hand. But at the same time, secondary imagination, it beautifies it with new words, new techniques and so on. Then what is the difference between primary, secondary imagination and fancy? Fancy is a kind of logical faculty. Okay. Secondary imagination, it is actually a poetic faculty, while fancy is a kind of logical faculty. For example, I can cook a food. Okay. I can cook a food with little ingredients. And at the same time, if I am a professional, I will use some more items like for taste, like soya sauce or tomato sauce in order to beautify it. At the same time, for even though I have all these all these ingredients, I wanted to add it at the correct time, at the correct measurement, and that is what we call as a fancy. So fancy is the mechanical ability that a poet has to use devices like metaphors, symbols, images, alliterations, etc. In poetry, to blend various ingredients into beautiful images. So that is a logical faculty or a mechanical ability of a poet. In November 2017, there was a question, for Coleridge, our power to perceive symbols gleaned from the world about us is related to the category of primary imagination, secondary imagination, fancy, and intuition. Once again, I will repeat the question. For Coleridge, our power to perceive symbols gleaned from the world about us. Okay. Answer is option one. That is primary imagination, because this is something that every human mind has. We all have a power to perceive symbols, because that depends upon how we perceive the world or how the world reads us. So that is primary imagination. So we don't have to put anything into it that we never had, but this is something that is naturally inherent in it. That is primary imagination. In July 2016, there was this question. In Biographia Literaria, Coleridge defines imagination as the faculty by which imagination. So once again, the question is about imaginations, where you have to identify a correct definition of imagination. The soul perceives the phenomenal diversity of the universe. The soul perceives the spiritual unity of the universe. The mind acquires images by its associative power. The mind separates images by its discriminative power. So the answer is option two. That is, the soul perceives the spiritual unity of the universe. Okay. So that is what imagination is to Coleridge. Every human being, our human mind, our soul, it has this power to understand the universe. Okay, so that is one attempt of a one mind, or that is one attempt to perceive the spiritual unity of the universe. And then he brings the concept of poetic genius and poetic talent. So that is another distinction brought by Coleridge in Biographia Literaria, poetic genius and poetic talent. So poetic genius, just like imagination, is inherent. We have to do nothing with it, but at the same time, poetic talent Poetic talent is just like fancy. You have to cultivate it. You have to learn it. You have to train it. So that's the difference between poetic genius and a poetic talent. So poetic genius, just like imagination is inherent, this is also inherent. Poetic talent, how it is acquired like fancy, this is also acquired. So these are the features of a poetic genius. Power of imagination, the depth of thought and emotion, shaping power of imagination, instinct for musical delight. So these are the four important points that you can find in the poetic genius. And in chapter 14, he coins this term called willing suspension of disbelief. Willing suspension of disbelief. So we know that there was an ideological clash between Wordsworth and Coleridge, where Wordsworth wanted everything to be simple. Wordsworth wanted everything to be believable. But this is an answer by Coleridge, that even though it is not believable, the readers, they have this willing suspension of disbelief. They know that this is not logical, but in order to not spoil the fun of reading, they will naturally accept it. That is how we believe in ghosts, we believe in the supernatural or gothic element. So that is what is called as willing suspension of disbelief. So remember, he introduced this concept in chapter 14. It is an intentional avoidance of critical thinking or logic in examining something surreal, such as a work of speculative fiction, in order to believe it for the sake of enjoyment. Because everyone knew that an albatross, it might never have a curse. But there is this tendency among the readers to give it a chance, or to make ourselves believe that, okay, there is a chance for something to happen. For example, believe you are watching a horror movie with 100% sure that, okay, this is fake, this is not real. Then you will never have this fun of watching a horror feeling or a horror movie. So what does normally we do? We let ourselves get afraid, or we let ourselves be fear. So that is what is called as willing suspension of disbelief. By this, he meant that the reader will accept the poem on its own terms, temporarily giving over to the author's vision of the world long enough to appreciate the work. And as I said in the starting of this session, his criticism on William Shakespeare also brought fame to him, and that can be collected as Lectures on William Shakespeare, which he had given from 1808 to 1819. This is basically about Shakespeare and his plays, and he made critical comments on Hamlet, Tempest, Richard II and Othello. And this is one famous quote said by Coleridge regarding the plays of William Shakespeare, that is, I love Antony and Cleopatra and King Lear. I love Antony and Cleopatra and King Lear, but hate Measure for Measure. Measure for Measure is not something favored by Coleridge, but at the same time, he loves the two plays written by Shakespeare, that is Antony and Cleopatra and King Lear. And he suggested that the plays have their own regular and organized unities. I have a smack of Hamlet, if I may say so. I have a smack of Hamlet, if I may say so. So this is another important quote by Coleridge regarding Shakespeare. June 2019, there was this question. To see him act is like reading Shakespeare by flashes of lighting. So this is a critical comment made by Coleridge on one of the famous Shakespearean actors. So the question options are David Garrick, Richard Burbage, John Kemble and Edmund Kean. So these four options, they are the Shakespearean actors. I mean, the actors who did the roles in the plays of William Shakespeare. And one among them, Coleridge felt that see him act is like reading Shakespeare by flashes of lighting. And the answer is option four, that is Edmund Kean. Okay, so you have to remember. So these are the areas that in which you can expect questions from Coleridge. So that's all for today's live session. So in today's live session, we discussed the biographical details of Coleridge. Then we moved on to the major works written by Coleridge. And finally, we discussed Coleridge as a literary critic. So if you are preparing for NTA NET exam, one important thing that you have to look is Samuel Taylor Coleridge, because as I said in the first session of this live, Samuel Taylor Coleridge is a must-look topic for NET exam, because for every exam you can find at least one question asked from Coleridge. Or if you want to answer any questions related to this romantic period where Coleridge comes as an option, it is again necessary to learn Coleridge. So please do have a look on the important works and the most important critical work written by Coleridge, that is Biographia Literaria. Thank you for today's live session. Thank you.